You ever have that feeling that your money just doesn't go as far as it used to? I mean, groceries, gas, rent. It feels like everything costs more. So what's going on? Why does the cash in your wallet seem to be losing its power right before your eyes?
Well, there's a simple one-word answer to this whole mystery. And that word is inflation. Okay, so what is inflation, really? Let's break it down. In the simplest terms, it's when the price of, well, just about everything goes up. And when that happens, the purchasing power of your money goes down. Every single dollar you have buys a little bit less than it did yesterday.
To really get our heads around this, we're going to break it down into three acts. So first up, let's dive into Act 1, the price of everything. This is all about that feeling you get at the checkout counter or when you're staring at the gas pump. You know, the real tangible hit of rising costs.
Now, I know it can seem super complex, but at its core, inflation is really driven by just three main forces. You can think of them as the main suspects in our little economic mystery. So, let's go investigate.
All right, suspect number one is something called demand pull inflation. So, what happens when basically everyone wants to buy more stuff than there is to go around? It's a classic case of supply and demand, right?
Economists have this perfect little phrase for it. Too much money chasing too few goods. You know, when a ton of people have cash burning a hole in their pockets and they all want the same limited stuff, well, prices are naturally going to get pulled upwards.
Think about a hot real estate market, for example. Let's say everyone suddenly rushes out to buy an apartment, but the number of apartments for sale hasn't changed. What do you think happens? Exactly. The sellers realize they can charge more, and boom, prices shoot up. That right there is demand pull inflation in action.
Okay, on to our second driver. This one is called cost push inflation. And in this case, prices don't rise because everyone's buying. No, they rise because it just gets more expensive to make the stuff in the first place.
Just think about the price of oil. I mean, oil is in almost everything. Transportation, manufacturing, even plastics. So if the global price of oil suddenly spikes, well, it gets more expensive to ship goods, it gets more expensive to run factories, and it gets more expensive to make all kinds of products. Now, companies aren't just going to eat that cost, are they? No way. They pass it right on to you, the consumer. And that's when you see those higher prices in the store.
And hey, it's not just about raw materials like oil. The exact same thing happens with labor costs. So, for instance, if workers in a huge manufacturing country successfully push for higher wages, what happens? The cost of making all those goods goes up. And that extra cost, it gets baked right into the final price of all the stuff we buy.
Okay, that brings us to our third driver. And honestly, this one might be the most fascinating of all. Because this one, it's not really about goods or money. It's about what's going on inside our own heads. It's the psychology of inflation.
Get this. It turns out that what we all believe will happen with prices tomorrow can actually change what happens today. It's a real thing. It's called inflationary expectations. And trust me, it is an incredibly powerful force.
Let's just walk through an example so you can see how this works. Imagine the news is buzzing with rumors about sanctions on a big oil-producing country. You and everybody else start thinking, oh man, gas prices are about to skyrocket. So what do? You dash to the gas station to fill up your tank right now while it's still kind of cheap. But here's the kicker. When millions of people do the exact same thing at the exact same time, that huge sudden spike in demand, well, it causes the very price jump everyone was scared of. The prophecy literally fulfills itself.
All right, so there you have it. Our three main drivers: demand pull, cost push, and our own expectations. But so what? How does all this theory actually affect your wallet? Let's get really practical here.
Okay, let's apply this to a massive financial decision, taking out a 20-year mortgage. Imagine you've got two choices. Option one, a fixed, nominal interest rate. Option two, an index-linked rate that actually changes with inflation. Now, if you think high inflation is coming, which one of those loans is the safer bet? What would you choose?
Well, the difference is absolutely massive. If you take that fixed, nominal rate loan, your monthly payment is locked in. That's it. So as inflation goes up, and maybe your salary does too, that mortgage payment just stays the same. It's like your debt is actually shrinking in real terms over time. But that index-linked loan? Whoa! Your payments and even the total amount you owe will actually increase with inflation. In a world of high inflation, that thing can become a serious financial trap.
And listen, this is not just some textbook theory. This really happened. Just look at Israel back in the 1980s. They went through a period of hyperinflation that peaked at an insane 400% a year. The people who had those fixed-rate loans, they were the winners. Their debt practically vanished. But for the folks with index-linked loans, it was a complete nightmare. Their debt exploded, and tragically, a lot of people lost their homes. It's a powerful lesson.
So the key takeaway here is pretty simple, but it's crucial. You have to kind of flip your thinking depending on whether you're borrowing or saving. When it comes to long-term debt, like a mortgage, a fixed rate is your best friend during high inflation. But for your savings, you want the exact opposite. You want to protect your money's value, so an index-linked account that actually grows with inflation is absolutely the smarter move.
Okay, for our final act, let's zoom all the way out. How does everything we've talked about apply to the, well, the pretty strange and puzzling economic world we're all living in right now?
And this is where we get to a real modern mystery. For years now, economists have been scratching their heads. We've had all the classic ingredients for major inflation, right? Massive government spending, super low unemployment, central banks printing literally trillions of dollars, and yet inflation has been weirdly, historically low. It's been defying all the old rules.
Some people have described this strange period of low inflation and super low interest rates as a narrow window of opportunity. It's this really unusual time that's allowed governments, companies, and people like you and me to borrow money incredibly cheaply. But here's the warning that comes with it. That window, it is not going to be open forever.
And that leaves us with a really critical question, doesn't it? When this window finally does close, and inflation comes back, and it probably will, are we going to be prepared? Are our governments ready? Are our financial systems ready? And most importantly, are you ready? Understanding the forces we've talked about today, well, that's the absolute first step to being prepared for whatever comes next.